from protein. This will allow the calcium to be shuttled outside the cell because the protein has changed its shape to allow the shuttle of calcium from low concentration to high concentration. So this is the animation for the calcium protein pump. The other one that we have is the sodium potassium pump. So in order to export sodium outside the cell against its concentration gradient, first sodium will attach to the transport protein. Then the ATP will attach itself to that transport protein and releases one of its phosphate group. The release of one phosphate group will cause that transport protein to change its conformation and allow sodium to be expelled into the and outside. At the same time, potassium will bind to the transport protein. The binding of that potassium to the transport protein will release the phosphate group that has been attached before, and this will allow the potassium to be uptake inside the cell, and then the process will continue for the sodium potassium pump. So here is the animation for the sodium potassium pump. The sodium will attach first, then the phosphate group will attach itself. This will allow the sodium to be transported out. At the same time, the potassium will get inside. Once it attaches to the transport protein, the phosphate group will leave. Finally, the potassium can get inside. So, for active transport, it is always working against the concentration gradient. Against this will generate an equal ion distribution. Finally, will generate potential differences. Potential difference is needed for osmoregulation, electrical activity, for nutrient intake, and biochemical processes. Therefore, since active transport requires energy, the number of mitochondria is high in cells that carry out active transport. So now we have covered the active transport. Finally, we will cover endocytosis and exocytosis. First, for endocytosis, cytosis is an active transport that involves infolding or outfolding of membrane section. This enables transport of larger, even larger molecules or bulk transport of material through the membrane either into the cells or out of cells. First, we will take a look for the endocytosis. Endocytosis can be divided into two. The first one is phagocytosis. For phagocytosis, the folds of plasma membrane will enclose a large material. The enclosed material is packaged in phagocytic back wall, and then the phagocytic back wall will fuse with lysosome that contains digestive enzyme. Finally, the ingested bacteria will be digested within the back wall. So here, as you can see there, the animation is not working, I'm sorry. But let's take a look here. So here you can see the bacteria is being eaten by the white blood cell by forming the phagocytic vesicle or the phagocytic back wall once it is being engulfed by the white blood cell. The second form of endocytosis is pinocytosis, in which the material is taken in liquid form. Liquids are trapped by the plasma membrane fold, and finally, the folding will then be pinched off into cytosol as tiny vesicles. So here is the animation in which the plasma membrane is being pinched and then being taken off into cytosol as tiny vesicles. And finally, we will take a look at the exocytosis. For exocytosis, it involves the cell release waste products or useful products such as hormones out of the cell. The vesicle or the vacuole surrounding the material will fuse with the plasma membrane finally, the contents will be spilled out of the cell. So here is the visualization of the exocytosis. The material is inside the vesicle. The vesicle will fill with the plasma membrane, and then the excreted material will be spilled out. So here is the summary for diffusion and facilitated diffusion. They are involved in the passive transport, and for active transport, it also require energy. So for cytosis, they also require energy. That they need the energy for the infolding or outfolding of the plasma membrane. So that is all for our lecture. Thank you.